Good morning and welcome to the 11th meeting in 2022 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. The first item on our agenda is to take evidence on the Scottish Government's Framework for Tax 2021. We're joined today by Tom Arthur, Minister for Public Finance, Planning and Community Wealth, and Mr Arthur is accompanied by Alex Doig, Deputy Director Tax at the Scottish Government. I welcome you both to the meeting and invite Mr Arthur to make a short opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. And let me begin by extending my thanks to the committee for inviting me to today's session to give evidence on Scotland's first framework for tax. I understand the committee is keen to learn more about the framework's purpose and content, and I'm very happy to discuss that today. The Framework for Tax builds on the Scottish approach to taxation, which was the subject of inquiry by the Finance and Constitution Committee during the previous session. It seeks to capture the key components of good tax policy making and to reflect the principles and processes that underpin our approach to tax, as well as our programme of work. In short, what is our identity in relation to tax policy? And what are we trying to do and why? As the committee will be aware, the Scottish approach to taxation is based on Adam Smith's well-recognised four principles for a good tax system: proportionality, certainty, convenience and efficiency. We added two additional principles to demonstrate our commitment to engaging and collaborating with stakeholders on tax policy and to underline the firm approach we take to tackling tax avoidance activity. Those principles remain a core part of the framework, although we have strengthened the final principle to capture effective tax policy making. That includes a firm approach to tax avoidance, and our resolve in that remains the same. But it recognises the importance of effective policy design and delivery as the first step to reducing the scope for avoidance practices. In developing the framework, we wanted to build on those principles by setting out, as clearly and as accessibly as possible, a fuller explanation of how we make tax policy in Scotland and sequence it around the Scottish budget process. In doing so, we expect to realise a number of benefits. Firstly, to demonstrate our commitment to openness and transparency, a key ingredient of any good tax system. Secondly, to lay the foundation for a process of continuous improvement, using feedback from stakeholders and policy evaluation to ensure best practice in how we design and deliver tax policy. Thirdly, to support our efforts to align the tax policy cycle as far as possible with the Scottish budget and UK fiscal events, which are of critical importance to the development of devolved and local tax policy. Fourthly, to be upfront about our priorities and programme of work for the course of this Parliament. Events and circumstances can change rapidly, and that can change the context within which we take tax policy decisions. COVID-19 is a profound example of that. However, setting out our intentions for taxpayers and businesses is important, particularly in times of volatility, which is what we have done. And finally, to demonstrate our desire for a more open, mature and informed debate about tax policy in Scotland, something I know that this committee is committed to. The framework is intended for a range of audiences. Our ambition was to make it as accessible and as easy to understand as possible. It is written concisely, jargon is minimised or explained, not an easy task in this area, and it sets out the extent of our powers and how the revenue we raise contributes to funding the Scottish budget. Communicating clearly on tax and engaging the public on tax policy is a priority for the Scottish Government. However, improving public understanding of tax cannot be achieved by government alone, and I am keen to work with the committee and all our interested stakeholders on initiatives that can help to achieve this. In that spirit, I want to take this opportunity to thank all those that contributed to the framework's production. We sought engagement with a wide range of stakeholders, including tax professionals, business representatives, third sector organisations and the general public. We also carried out a two-month consultation process during September and October last year. The feedback we received was incredibly valuable and constructive and made a positive contribution to the final version of the framework published on 16 December last year, which was warmly welcomed by stakeholders. I genuinely believe that we have a product that has been co-produced, and I'm extremely grateful to all those who contributed for their expertise and advice. I will end by looking to the future. As I hope is clear, the framework acts as a foundation for tax policy in Scotland. There are aspects, such as the programme of work chapter, that will need refreshing to reflect changes to our work, and we plan to revise this chapter around the Parliament's midpoint. But our intention is that the framework as a whole will stand the test of time and can be built upon further. This acknowledges that one document can never be a silver bullet for every issue or challenge we face. What the framework does is demonstrate our commitment to good guardianship in relation to our devolved and local tax powers. That must be a sustained commitment to continuous improvement, which is why, for example, we published an evaluation of the changes made to income tax in 2018-19 alongside the framework. And it is also why we will work with the Parliament to reconvene the Devolved Taxes Legislation Working Group, allowing more detailed consideration of how we can improve the way we consult on and make legislation on devolved taxes. But coming back, Convener, to what I said at the outset, the framework provides a foundation for the design and delivery of tax policy in Scotland, policies that support the recovery, national outcomes and a pursuit of a fairer, greener and more prosperous Scotland for everyone. And on that, I will conclude, and I look forward to the discussion that will ensue. Thank you.
Okay, well, thank you very much for that. That was a very interesting statement. Certainly, a lot of questions, I believe, will emerge from it. And I just want to begin with the two new principles, if I may, Minister. See, the first one you said was engagement to promote public understanding. You talked about how it's important to communicate clearly and engage the public in your statement. So, what form is that engagement and communication taking?
Well, in the first instance, is how this document itself, which is described as a foundational document, was created. There was extensive consultation. So, for example, there was a process of pre-consultation with Revenue Scotland and other parties. We had the public consultation over September and October, and then following that, we had further engagement with stakeholders, including Revenue Scotland, to refine that the proposals that were contained within the strategy, within the framework, rather. And the framework reflects that extensive engagement. To give maybe perhaps one or two specific examples of our process to engagement, if we look at one of the commitments in the work programme around the additional dwelling supplement review, that is work that is underway at the moment. We have undertaken a public consultation, which closed earlier this month, and we have also taken forward significant engagement with stakeholders, both at official level and indeed at ministerial level. I've chaired a roundtable at the start of this month, and we will respond fully to that process during the summer. So that is, for example, one area. Another area in the work programme, which reflects the joint agreement between the Scottish Government and the Scottish Green Party, is around council tax, which is the establishment of a working group to look at deliberative processes culminating in a citizens' assembly to look at resourcing of local government, including council tax. So to give an example of engagement of the widest possible kind, a citizens' assembly, which will be looking at resourcing of local government, including council tax. So I hope that demonstrates there's a wide array of ways in which we are taking forward our commitment to transparency and engagement with the people of Scotland on how we design tax policy.
Okay, thanks. It's not really public engagement, though, is it? It's stakeholders and people like that. And many will be at the Citizens' Assembly, 100 folk, whatever.
Well, as you just say, that well, there is that engagement with stakeholders, but also were public consultations. So there was a public consultation in this document. There was a public consultation with regards to the additional dwelling supplement. So we have that balanced approach. We have that detailed engagement with stakeholders, but there's also that opportunity for wider public consultation and discussion. And, of course, continuous engagement with Parliament as well.
Okay, prior to the devolution of, income tax, etc., in the run-up to 2017, there was a lot of discussion about tax avoidance and about how Scotland would develop differently from the United Kingdom Parliament in terms of how they addressed this. So I'm just wondering how that has evolved over the years, and because one of the other principles, new principles, you said, a view to minimising tax avoidance. So what has been the Scottish Government's method, if you want to put it that way, of minimising tax avoidance, and how does that differ from the UK?
Well, I would refer members to the decision-making matrix that's contained within the document, and that lists six particular aspects of how we go around making decisions on tax policy. They're not numbered, but the one in the bottom of the column speaks around delivery and administration. And what that makes clear is the need for detailed and continuous engagement throughout the process of policy design. So, for example, with a fully devolved tax such as LBTT or Scottish landfill tax, and indeed for the other taxes that have still to come online, aggregates levy and air passenger duty or air departure tax, that engagement would come with Revenue Scotland, who can provide that expertise at the outset. And that can help to shape and inform how we engage, how we go about developing legislation. Ultimately, where our role sits within that particular process is in the legislation that Parliament passes. And we want the legislation to reflect best practice and for it to be informed by the expertise of those who are responsible for operational matters in tax and who obviously act independently, the example I've just given being Revenue Scotland. So that close engagement and work right from the outset in policy design through to implementation with the relevant tax authority. Similarly, should proposals emerge out of the work on local taxation and reforms, local authorities as the tax administration with regards to local tax in this case, there would be that early engagement from the outset so that we're considering the operational matters where from the outset and that in its turn can inform how we go about drafting legislation.
Sorry, my understanding was that the Scottish Government in terms of tax avoidance was going to take a principled approach as opposed to the UK's position whereby, you know, unless something is specifically addressed in legislation, then there's an opportunity for avoidance. Whereas in the Scottish context, it was going to be if it was perceived that the intention was to avoid tax, even though it wasn't, you know, in tablets of stone, then, for example, they would still be able to collect the taxation. John was in the committee at the time, and that was deliberated over. Are we not moving forward with that? I mean, because I understood that was going to be what was going to be a significant difference between Scotland and the UK to minimise tax avoidance.
That principle is still contained within it, and it's why we've expanded it beyond just referring to tax avoidance, but looking at effectiveness. So just looking at it in the round, we want effective pot tax policy that does what it says on the tin, and reducing and minimising opportunities for avoidance is a key part of that. But to actually how you go about minimising avoidance, it needs that detailed input from those who administer and deliver the tax on the ground. That technical expertise is extremely valuable and of importance. So in terms of what I set out with regards to the framework and the decision-making matrix and the need to be considering delivery and administration from the outset, that's the sort of practical approach that's contained within the framework for tax that informs how we go about designing legislation that is effective and being effective, you know, builds upon the existing principles that you refer to with regards to minimising opportunities for avoidance. I don't know if there was anything you'd want to add to that, Alex, in terms of how in developing the framework, how consideration was given to building upon the avoidance principle.
No, I think that's right. I think it's not waiting for avoidance activity to take place, but looking at the way you design tax policy so that you minimise those opportunities and give yourself every opportunity to have a robust policy that can be delivered and administered by the tax authority in a way that doesn't give those opportunities for tax avoidance. So, as the Minister said, it's putting that up front rather than waiting for an avoidance practice to emerge and then reacting to it. That will probably happen at some point. You know, with any tax, there's always going to be those sorts of situations, and government has to respond and tax authorities have to respond. But the point about the framework is good tax policy design starts from the very outset, and if you engage the tax authority at that time and engage them in the process of policy design, the hope would be, or the aspiration would be, that you would avoid those situations and those practices or limit the scope for those avoidance practices to take place.
And is that different from the UK?
I think it's difficult to answer that question. I mean, it's a very broad question, and
because you know, we're talking about a Scottish tax framework, I'm just wanting to see what's Scottish about it. How does it differ from the UK? Basically, it's just, you know, I mean, I understood that this principled approach was a significant difference, but I would have thought that any legislature anywhere would want to try and, you know, make sure that avoidance was minimised when it set a tax. Otherwise, what's the point in setting a tax? You know,
I can only speak to this framework and the Scottish Government's approach, but certainly, as the Minister said, from the outset, we've been clear about anti-avoidance. And in terms of this framework, we've actually broadened that out to acknowledge the fact that you need to take action early to make sure a tax is well designed in order to limit the scope for tax avoidance. So that's all I can speak to in terms of Scottish Government's position.
OK, thank you for that. We'll move on then. I mean, basically, one of the things that the framework talks about is to ensure that Scotland's public finances are fiscally sustainable. And fiscal sustainability is an issue that has certainly drawn the attention of the committee, because the Scottish Fiscal Commission pointed out, for example, that by 2024-25, which will come round a lot sooner than we perhaps think, is forecast to increase beyond Social Security spending is going to increase beyond the block grant adjustment by £764 million, they said, and that was before the Scottish Government delivered a 6% uplift in benefits. So how are we going to ensure, how is this framework going to try and ensure fiscal sustainability?
Well, with regards to how we use our tax powers, the framework, I think, sets out a range of principles which are applicable to the question if you ask, but perhaps if I maybe just picked one or two. Having to look at policies in the around, I made reference to the decision-making matrix, and so that's having to look not just in terms of how we adhere to the principles and the objectives that are set out within the framework, but more broadly, how our taxes interact with other taxes, devolved and local taxes and UK taxes, and how it interacts with the broader policy landscape in which we operate within, including social security. So that's built into how we go around considering tax policy development, decision making and implementation, is to take that broader approach. Now clearly that has to be looked at on a case by case basis. Now you raised the issue of forecast expenditure on social security. Decisions around allocation of funding are of course taken as part of the budget process, and I'm conscious that we're moving into the territory of spend. With regards to what we're doing around tax, is if it ultimately comes back to how do you use the tax system to maximise return on revenues? Well, we've just spoken about, you know, wanting to minimise avoidance for one, but key, you know, a key principle of course is certainty, and we seek to provide that certainty, which is of much of benefit to business. So take for example around one of the only sort of major business tax that we control, non-domestic rates. Our commitments there around the poundage, around small business bonus scheme and maintaining that for the length of the Parliament, our commitment to, for example, business growth accelerator, fresh start relief, giving that long-term assurance to users of the tax system that there will be consistency in the policy landscape. So that's an example of where the principle of certainty is applied to how we implement tax policy in Scotland can help to achieve that aim of sustainable revenues. But clearly it's a much broader question, because ultimately tax is about the collection of revenues. In terms of revenue generation, when we get into sort of broader economic considerations,
a productive and in fact an increasingly productive economy, and it has to be increasingly productive per capita because of the demographic challenge that we're actually facing. And one of the things, evidence that we got from, for example, from the Scottish Property Federation, but also others, is that the projections in terms of non-domestic rates are wholly unrealistic. I mean, more and more people are moving to online shopping, for example. I don't think anyone really believes we'll return to the pre-COVID situation in terms of high street spending, yet the Scottish Government is predicting a 25% increase in revenues over the next 3-4 years from that source. I mean, So how is this being addressed? I mean, because if the Scottish Government is to maintain budget levels roughly where they are, even and we have these real major issues in terms of the social security shortfall, and we're not going to generate the funds that the Scottish Government is predicting in terms of non-domestic rates, how is the tax system going to address that? I mean, you have said, for example, in your report that you know, there'll be steps taken to grow the tax base. What does that mean? Does it mean additional taxes or more people going into work in order to have more taxpayers, which frankly is what most of us would like to see? I'm just wondering how you square these circles.
Yeah, it's a really excellent set of questions, Convener, and I'm trying to think of a way I can answer them concisely in the space of, you know, 90 seconds, a couple of minutes.
You can take as long as you like.
So I'll be happy to. Okay, let's maybe break it down. Taking the broad issue around productivity, we've just published a national strategy for economic transformation. So that speaks about a range of measures, you know, productivity, skills at the heart of that. Issues around growing the working age population, we recognise that, but we operate within the constraints of the Scotland Act. We do not have control, you know, over the levers of migration, and that is a huge issue. It's been compounded by Brexit.
But hold on a second. There's no reason why we can't attract migrants from other parts of the United Kingdom if we've got a growing and thriving economy. It's not all about bringing people from overseas. As I mentioned before, this committee, some constituencies in Edinburgh get 7,000 or 8,000 EU citizens living and working here. My constituency is less than 300, not because there's any difference in migration between Ayrshire and Edinburgh, because the economy in Edinburgh is so much stronger. So, you know, that's migration in terms of people from other countries is important. But what about migration from within the UK of working age people, not folk who come to, you know, Arran and Argyll to retire, for example, but or Perthshire, but to actually come and work and contribute to the economy?
Yeah, it's a fair point. So I wasn't suggesting that migration is a silver bullet. It's part of a broader range of measures. The important thing as well, if we're going to look at intra-UK migration, we have to look at what is the employment level across the UK. Some of the challenges that we're facing around skill shortage and a tight labour market are not unique to Scotland. They're UK-wide challenges as well. So that creates challenges in that particular sphere. Reference was made to the high street and the changing nature of, I suppose, retail. Parliament will be aware of us going to be the publication of a retail strategy shortly, so I can't preempt what's in that, but there will also, but that is something that has grown out of a piece of work that was in collaboration with business, with academia, with trade unions, with the third sector, with the public sector. There is the work that we are undertaking in partnership with COSLA for an updated town centre action plan. Again, that came out of an independent review that was conducted. So in terms of the policy interventions that government can take, be it on national strategy for economic transformation, retail strategy, town centred action plan, looking longer term, what we're seeking to do around NPF4 and the planning system, there's a range of policy levers that we can pull, but there's no one single lever that can address all of these particular issues in one fell swoop. So I hope that sort of captures the fact there's a range of different initiatives going on, but ultimately there's limits to what we can do within the existing suite of powers that we have at our disposal. You know, the main macroeconomic levers, employment law, are still reserved to Westminster. So we have to operate within those limitations. So it's a much broader question. We know it's going beyond the framework for tax, which I suppose we're specifically considering this morning. But there is that broader range of work going on to help ultimately increase productivity, increase prosperity, and as such that for that to translate into earnings and increased tax take.
Okay, I'm just going to mention a couple of wee things because I want to let other people in. One is the issue of the North Sea. Now, obviously, we've got a lot of highly paid workers there, I think 71,000 at the last count, and they earn more than average. The Scottish average, so they pay a lot more in tax than the average. If we're switching to green jobs, what is the Scottish Government doing to look at how that will impact on the tax base? And sorry, and secondly, just so I don't take up too much of your time, Minister, and let others in, has the Scottish Government looked at the issue of behavioural change? Because obviously if we're short of taxes, governments can be tempted just to put taxes up. But the impact of that is always, you know, you may increase taxes in the short term, but if it dissuades people from A, investing here, or B, living here, and therefore paying their taxes either in the rest of the UK or elsewhere, then you effectively lose, you know, you lose everything. So there's a half a loaf's better than no bread kind of analogy there. So those two things, North Sea oil, I know the Cambo announcement today is that perhaps there'll be a because of rocketing fuel prices and the Russian-Ukrainian situation, that North Sea oil might have a wee bit more life in it than we thought. But certainly, I'm just wanting to know what the Scottish Government is doing to look, because this is obviously going to be a long-term issue, and indeed behavioural change is a matter that's always going to be with us with regard to taxation.
Okay. It's a latter point about behavioural change. One of the principles is obviously efficiency, which captures about, is we don't want tax policy that leads to distortionary effects, which ultimately undermine the objective of revenue raising. So that's built in as a well-understood principle. It was in the Scottish approach to taxation previously. It's one of the Adam Smith principles. So efficiency and being conscious of the impact of behavioural change is something, as I say, it's a key, it's one of the key six, it's one of the six key principles. In North Sea, it fundamentally comes down to a just transition. These are highly skilled workers, and the task is, in transitioning away from oil and gas, is to ensure that we retain those skill sets and are deployed within the emerging technologies and renewables and the wider green economy. And to that end, through the support, you know, £500 million of investment going to, committed to the North East as part and a wide range of other interventions across the employability sphere, National Transition Training Fund, for example. So ultimately, the task is about growing highly skilled, highly paid jobs in the green economy, and that, to an extent, will be able to absorb much of, you know, the skilled workers and talent that will see opportunities within oil and gas decline as that declines as a resource and an industry in the coming years and decades. And these workers, the aim is to in effecting that just transition, is to allow them to transition into opportunities in these emerging renewable areas, which have the potential to be highly skilled, highly paid jobs, and as such, compensate for the loss of the jobs in oil and gas.
I think some of them might just find it easier to move to Saudi, actually, and pay their taxes over there or something like that. You know, if we don't actually get the highly paid, highly skilled jobs that we're talking about. But anyway, let's move on. I'm going to open out the session to colleagues around the table. The first person to ask a question will be John, followed by Daniel.
Thank you very much. Convener, unusually for me to get come in second, so that's very nice for a change. You've mentioned council tax reform and that it's going to Citizens' Assembly and so on. So could I press you on that a little bit for a timescale? What is the soonest we could have a replacement tax in place?
It's a fair question. I'm not in a position, just to be upfront, to give you a concrete timescale at the moment. It's a commitment. It is a key priority. It is something I'm working to take forward. And it will be... I think, as opposed to answer the question directly, is that I don't want to preempt what the outcome of a citizen assembly would be. Now, if we think about the wording...
Although, could we assume that it will not be to support council tax?
But it's not just council tax, it's resourcing of local government and council tax. So there's that. So there's a question of the process that leads up to that, the engagement with COSLA. But ultimately, what a Citizens' Assembly, through its deliberations, decides upon, I can't preempt. And ultimately, what comes out of that Citizens' Assembly will have to be considered against the framework that we're discussing for today. And a key part of that will be on, you know, delivery and administration. Now, there's a range of possibilities. I don't want to start indulging in speculation, but I'm sure members can imagine a range from relatively minor changes to quite significant and fundamental reform. What emerges on that spectrum, some elements could be addressed fairly straightforwardly. Other would, for example, you know, potentially require primary legislation. So there's a broad array of possible outcomes. So that's why it's difficult for me to, at this particular stage to say what, you know, how quickly anything could be implemented.
Well, I mean, could we at least have a range then? Because, I mean, I think most of the parties here are against council tax, so therefore we'd need a new tax, therefore we'd need primary legislation. Presumably that could not happen before the next election. But, I mean, what's the far away distance? I mean, you know, are we definitely going to have something within 10 years?
Well, I think there's a recognition that there's a process as well involved of legislating in, a process of implementation, and I think there's a recognition that in terms of actually going from where we are now to a new system being fully embedded and operational would go beyond the lifetime of this Parliament. But what the commitment is to do within this Parliament and to do at pace is to do the groundwork to establish that Citizens' Assembly and allow for that Citizens' Assembly to be able to report back to Parliament in sufficient time so that Parliament can consider what its response is.
I mean, I'm not arguing against any of that. It's 31 years since we had the last revaluation. You know, so there has been quite a lot of groundwork done over the last 31 years. And I mean, if it's, say, going to be 10 years before we get a replacement tax, does that mean we need a revaluation in the meantime? Because, you know, as I see it, some properties, in, perhaps in the better off areas, have gone up in value, say, 10 times since 1991. In a poorer area like mine, they've gone up a lot less, which suggests that in a poorer area, my constituents are paying less council tax than they should, or sorry, paying more council tax than they should be, and in richer areas they're paying less. So, should if it's going to take a long time, should we not have a revaluation in the meantime?
No, it's not our policy to have a revaluation of council tax at this time. What we are clear on is we have a commitment through the joint agreement with the Scottish Green Party that we're going to have a deliberative process culminating in the Citizens' Assembly to look at sources of funding for local government, including council tax. That is going to be delivered within this session of Parliament. It is a priority for me as Public Finance Minister. We're taking that work forward, and ultimately it will be for Parliament and Government will of course respond as well to what the Citizens' Assembly ultimately concludes should succeed council tax or what in council tax should change. I think at the moment what we can do is provide ahead of that certainty and continuity with our existing arrangements on council tax, and then once the Citizens' Assembly has had the opportunity to consider the matter in detail, we can then take on board those recommendations and move forward from there.
Okay, thank you. On a different subject, VAT, I mean, the plan was to assign part of VAT. I think there have been practical problems with that. And one of the reasons, I think, for assignment, if I'm not mistaken, was that the European Union would not allow us to vary VAT within the UK while we were in the EU. But that constraint, I assume, is now removed. So what is the government's position on VAT? And is that something we're discussing with the UK? And where are we going?
Yeah, our position is that VAT should be devolved. I mean, there's three areas we would like to see devolved. We would like to see... notwithstanding our overall constitutional position is clearly understood, but in the context of the fiscal framework review and what further devolution could take place, full devolution over the remaining aspects of income tax, national insurance contributions and VAT, which is something, as you rightly state, is now more would be achievable in a way in which it wasn't when the Smith Commission and the 2016 Scotland Act were passed. And as for... And I think we would recognise, and I know this is an area that the committee has explored, and the previous committee in the last session explored as well, is some of the challenges around methodology with that assignment. Because fundamentally, it's important to remember that assignment isn't a power; it's really just an accounting mechanism. So there is an opportunity to look at the full devolution of that, and that's something we would want to see considered as part of the fiscal framework review.
Okay, and you mentioned national insurance as well. Now, I mean, I'm quite keen. I don't know how far ahead the government has thought about what it would do if it did get national insurance and maybe fuller control over income tax. I mean, I'd like to see the two combined in a much, much simpler system. Has the government done work on that kind of thing, or is that too far down the road?
That's too far, but obviously the important thing with national insurance contributions is its interaction with the benefit system. So that's got to be borne in mind as well, and a still significant majority of social security is still reserved and controlled at Westminster. But what I suppose bringing it back to the framework provides that a means of considering and scrutinising any proposals around new taxes to be devolved and indeed how they should be implemented and delivered. But where you can perhaps say a practical, immediate piece of work that could be done around national insurance contributions wherever to be devolved is addressing the marginal rate where you have the gap between the Scottish higher rate and the UK upper earnings limit. So there's something that could be achieved, I think, relatively quickly. Fundamental consideration around the role of the tax and how it interacts with income tax more broadly would be a complex matter, and I think the way the methodology outlined in the framework would provide a way of
considering any changes and scrutinising and testing proposals.
Okay, I mean, I kind of accept that would have to be what would happen. We'd do something minor to start with and then maybe more major. And I think that the final issue I wanted to touch on was, what about completely new taxes, which I think, although we have to get Westminster agreement, it is a possibility, but we've not done very much on that. I mean, for example, it has been suggested over the years that we don't really get enough out of the whisky industry. It's a huge export, and a production tax on whisky, say £1 a bottle, could make quite a difference. Have you any thoughts about completely new taxes?
Again, we are obviously open to proposals, and I think what you're referring to is in Section 80B in the Scotland Act, but that is not without its significant challenges. It requires the agreement of the UK Parliament as well, and also has to be run through a set of tests, and I think it could be quite a challenging process. I would just give an example, some of the sort of very basic requests that we've made to the UK government around the aforementioned national insurance marginal rate, or on aspects around VAT and refurbishing properties, where we've not been able to make progress in these simple areas. It doesn't bode well for dialogue on potential devolution of new national taxes. But of course, these are things that we keep under review. And as a framework sets out, it sets out a process about how that could be considered. I don't know if there's anything you want to add, Alex, just about the process for devolution of new national taxes via ATB.
Yeah, so there was actually one new national tax added into the Scotland Act, which was in relation to wild fisheries. And that was a very specific measure and had a very specific context. So we don't really see that as being an example of something that would be akin to something substantive in the way that you're describing it. But yeah, there would have to be a process whereby we would engage with the UK government, go through their tests, and then there would have to be legislation, Westminster, and obviously in the Scottish Parliament. So, it's difficult to say how long it would take, because it's a case-by-case situation. But we'd anticipate that process could be quite lengthy. That would be something that we'd have to work through in order to get to a proposal in the end.
So just to clarify, I hadn't realised that if we were to have a new tax, and I'll stick with whisky production tax, Westminster would have to legislate on that first?
We would need, the mechanism that the Minister mentioned is Section 80B of the Scotland Act. That requires secondary legislation at Westminster in order to add the powers for the devolved tax into the Scotland Act. At the same time, we would have to be making progress on making arrangements for the tax in Scotland,
yes,
which I assume would need primary legislation in the Scottish Parliament, plus all the arrangements required for collection administration with Revenue Scotland. So there would be those two parts of the process. Mm-hmm. But I think what the Minister was referring to was the dialogue and engagement between the Scottish Government and the UK Government around a willingness to devolve powers in relation to a particular tax proposal. Mm-hmm. And that would also be part of the process.
I mean, if I could just make a final point. In some ways, you're saying that with devolution of taxes like national insurance or income tax, which we've already got partial control of, it does take a long time with Westminster. I mean, in some ways, from their point of view, can you not imagine it might be cleaner just to give us a completely new tax, which doesn't affect them in a sense, whereas obviously everything we do in income tax does affect them. So, I don't know, it's just a thought, but I mean, maybe they'd be willing?
Well, obviously, you appreciate the government's view is that there should be this Parliament to enjoy the full fiscal levers that, that an independent country would enjoy. And certainly short of that, within devolution, we've highlighted three areas in income tax, national insurance and VAT where we think there can be further devolution. The question ultimately would be a matter with through the ATB mechanism is that the UK government would have to make a judgment as to whether or not they felt any new national tax in Scotland impacted upon the wider UK economy, and that's where the challenge I think would arise.
Okay, thanks, Convener.
Okay, thank you. Dan's before by Ross.
Thank you very much. Yeah, and I'd like to really follow up some of the lines of questioning that you commenced. At the outset, though, can I just say, I think the fiscal framework, the fiscal the framework for tax, I'm getting my frameworks mixed up, apologies, Minister, is useful, but I think in a sense it's incredibly high level, and I wonder about the specifics and actually how things are measured. Just following up on what the convener was asking, you know, the Scottish Fiscal Commission set out very clearly the issues that we are facing over the next 4 to 5 years, both in terms of shortfalls in income tax and indeed welfare commitments, the combination of those coming to close to £1 billion. The fundamental dynamic here is that if income tax receipts per capita grow more slowly than they grow per capita across the rest of the UK, we receive less money to spend on Scottish public services. Given that is so fundamental to the way that public finances work in Scotland, why isn't that laid out specifically and explicitly within the framework?
Well, what you're referring to is just to one specific tax, income tax. This is a framework for all tax in Scotland, and it's looking at the decision-making process that underpins that. And of course, we set out the fiscal cycle and how we seek to, with regards to the decisions that the UK government takes. So you made the point it is a high-level document. It is indeed a high-level document. Decisions around individual taxes themselves are taken as part of the budget process. What this document is setting out is the way we go about, in a high-level sense, around our approach to tax policy overall, and the principles and objectives that inform how we go about taking these particular decisions. So, for example, you make a point about the SFC forecasts, and obviously important to acknowledge that they are forecasts and we're coming out of quite a volatile period. You would then want to consider decisions against the relevant principles. So the principles that I think you're looking at, or perhaps the objectives that you're looking around, are stable revenues. So where the stable revenues as one of the strategic objectives, how does that align with decision-making around income tax? Well, if we look at income tax and it's in terms of forecasts in Scotland, before we take into account the block grant adjustment, income tax is forecast by the SFC, income tax returns are forecast to increase year on year. The challenge ultimately, of course, as you correctly identify, is the relationship with the rest of the UK and the faster growth in earnings. So ultimately, in terms of what we're doing with our tax policy, we're actually increasing the revenue raised in Scotland year on year. The challenge comes with the operation of the fiscal framework. And again, that's something that can be, should be considered as part of the review.
But that's a bit my point, is that given that dynamic in terms of the growth on the average receipt per capita determines so significantly what is ultimately, I mean, I need to double check, but I mean, from memory, it's about 20-25% of the revenue that we have to spend in Scotland. Certainly in terms of overall tax policy that the Scottish Government has as its control. I mean, you correctly say that there are a number of taxes, this is about all tax, but the lion's share of that is income tax. I mean, it dwarfs all the other taxes that we have at our control. So given that is such a fundamental dynamic, that it's so important for determining whether we have more money to spend or less compared to pre-devolution, I just wonder why that's not as explicitly stated. And again, in your answer there, you said, given that the fiscal framework is complex, why isn't it baked into the framework? I just don't really understand.
I think it's because it's about how one specific tax operates. This document is designed to be high level and to be accessible and to inform and to provide transparency about the way in which we take decisions. Now, for example, if we were to go and to have a deep dive into the operation of the fiscal framework and block grant adjustments for income tax, it would necessitate doing it across every single tax that is referred to within the framework. And as such, it goes from being a concise, high-level document that seeks to provide clarity into something that's quite dense and ultimately would not be realising what its stated purpose is. But of course, there is, you know, sort of voluminous material on the operation of the fiscal framework. We set out, you know, income tax policy as part of the budget. We have a specific, you know, debate in Parliament at rates resolution. So there's that opportunity for fuller consideration. And of course, we are transparent in how we go about engaging with the UK government as regards to the upcoming review of the fiscal framework. So I take the point, but I think ultimately, if you start going into a huge amount of detail on the operation of the fiscal framework within this document, it starts to lose its overall purpose. I don't know, perhaps I appreciate just you may have an insight in terms of how consideration was given to what is included and what wasn't included within the framework in terms of how it was developed, and maybe it can help to elucidate some of the points I'm trying to make.
Yeah, no, I think you've covered the essence in that this is a framework for tax, it's about tax policy making. It does talk about continuous improvement, it does talk about evaluation, and we have evaluated income tax policy changes that were made. But I think the question is more geared about a tax performance issue in relation to income tax. So there are things that are in the framework that refer to that issue and how we'll have to continue to try to understand what's going on there as part of that process. But fundamentally, by design, it is quite a high-level document because it's talking about the way that you approach tax policy overall and not necessarily how you would approach or deal with a specific issue in relation to tax performance. I'm not sure if that's helpful, but...
Yes, I'll think about that, whether it's helpful or not. Let me move on a little bit. I mean, you just mentioned there about evaluation, and evaluation is really important. But there isn't a single reference to how that evaluation will take place, certainly not in terms of measurement. I'm just wondering why a broad approach to what measures would be taken into consideration to assess the various elements of the framework wasn't included.
So, is there a specific aspect of evaluation that you're concerned with? Is it evaluation overall of how the framework...
Well, look, you've got four objectives: stable revenues, well-being economy, national outcomes, and responsiveness to societal shifts. If you've got objectives, surely you should have a way of measuring them.
Well, with well-being economy, we're committed to well-being economy metrics. With the national performance framework, that's been published online and is routinely updated to demonstrate our performance against the national outcomes. And with stable revenues, we have a process of reporting through outturns, consolidated accounts and the budget process. So, in response to societal shifts, is ultimately something that I think is just reflected as and when it happens and what the policy response would be. So maybe how one evaluates that is slightly more challenging. But in the other areas, it's stable revenues, national performance framework, and wellbeing economy, which we're going to be developing the metrics on. There's clear data that will be provided to allow any individual or organisation, or indeed to allow Parliament to evaluate independently, as well as allowing government to evaluate as well in terms of the performance of tax. So these exist independently of this particular... These means of evaluation exist independently of the framework.
But I mean, by definition, you're talking about very broad areas that have a huge number of metrics attached to them, especially well-being. Are you saying that each one of the measures that is of equal value? I mean, how do these get compared? How do you even compare the different objectives and balance them? That there's not even at a high level a reference as to how you would balance or compare the different objectives that you have in your framework. Is that not a fairly fundamental point of a framework?
Well, it is, but ultimately these are going to be a reflection of judgment and values. So I think we would all... And I think it's important as well to understand the interconnected nature of those aspects. Stable revenues are fundamental to delivering the public services that we require for a well-being economy. And a well-being economy is fundamental to achieving the national outcomes. And the national outcomes themselves of creating a society that is wealthier, more prosperous and fairer is going to be fundamental to creating the conditions to generate further revenues and create sustainable revenue. So they're interrelated and shouldn't necessarily be looked at independently of each other. There's a correlation, they're mutually complementary.
That's a bit my point. Anyway, just moving on, I just really want to come back to a very specific point that the convener raised around non-domestic rates. Now, if you're saying that this framework should be responsive to societal shifts, then surely, given everything that is going on, given that online sales are now between a quarter and 30%, depending on the point in time that you pick, of total retail sales, that would suggest that you have to have a fundamental review of non-domestic rates, especially if you're using this framework properly.
I take the point you're making. Specifically on non-domestic rates, we had Barclay fairly, it was only a few years ago, and that is still to be fully implemented by the revaluation. But what I will say is that you'll have, I'm sure have noted the report that Fraser Vallander Institute undertook on the small business bonus scheme. I think one of the key findings that emerged from that was around data, and that's something we're reflecting on very carefully. And we're going to establish a short life working group to look at this in more detail, because I recognise that if you want to get to a position where you want to look at more reform of non-domestic rates, then I think the starting point is to make sure we have the data to inform that particular policy conversation. So we're looking very carefully and reflecting very carefully upon the FAI report, and particularly on that aspect around the need for more data, because I think we would recognise that there is not always a direct correlation between the rateable value of a property and the performance of the business which uses that property. And so a way to help address that is to ensure that we have robust procedures and mechanisms in place for gathering data. But I think it's the lack of data was, I think, the key issue that FAI identified. And addressing that, I think, is a prerequisite before you start to think about broader considerations around policy reform.
Although there is, you know, the data points I was referencing were from the National Audit Office. So, I mean, they are at a global level.
There is. There was the review of business rates in England, as you'll be aware, and ultimately where they landed on was ultimately recommending that in England, as you start doing things that we're already doing up here, you know, shorter revaluation cycles, interventions such as an equivalent of the BGA. So it's an example of, you know, a neighbouring jurisdiction which has considered this issue. They did not land on a proposition for fundamental and wholesale reform. But obviously one of the things that we are committed to looking at is, for example, around an online sales tax, which I appreciate in the retail context, and some of the challenges that our town centres and high streets have been facing has been an ask. And so that's a commitment we've undertaken. There was a manifesto commitment to look at, for example, an online sales tax. I recognise that there's been various calls, not the language I would use, but around levelling the playing field is how it's been characterised by some stakeholders. So that's something we've taken forward, but we also have to be cognisant of the work that the UK government's doing in this area as well, and the potential for a UK-wide digital sales tax. But to go back to the original point about NDR, we have to effectively get to revaluation and letting Barclay bed in, and then we're considering, as I say, in detail how we're going to respond to those are key points that are identified by FAI. But I think you probably will recognise that having the data in place to inform, to allow for a more informed discussion around potential options of further reform is a first step.
I'll leave it there, Convener.
Okay, thank you. Ross, followed by Liz.
Convener, just sticking with that point of the digital sales tax, Minister, the paper mentions the government's going to explore that. Are you in a position at the moment to give us a bit more detail on how that process will be taken forward? Presuming that a UK-wide sales tax is not forthcoming in the immediate future, and with the difficulties that have been mentioned already this morning about the devolution of new national taxes to Scotland, is this something you're considering exploring with COSLA as a potential local taxpayer? I'm just keen to understand how we're going to move forward from a commitment in principle to explore it into a process that would flesh that out.
Yeah, I think you flag up one of the challenges around how you actually move from idea to implementation. I think at this particular stage, it's want to see what's happening at a UK level first. I think that we need to have that sense of what the larger sort of tax landscape is going to be like before we can proceed. I just don't think it would be the most effective deployment of, you know, resource at this time when we may find ourselves in a situation that we can work up a proposal only for it to be superseded by something that is implemented from Westminster. So we have to see how that process pans out. Obviously, if the UK government's in a position where it decides not to legislate or progress in this area, then we can consider how we can take that forward. But as I said, it's obviously it's something that is referenced within the framework. It's a manifesto commitment. It's a shared principle between the government and the Scottish Green Party, and it's something we want to see fully explored. But as I say, we have to wait and see what the UK government's been doing first.
Thanks. And just returning to the convener's original line of questioning around fiscal sustainability, we know that we will need to significantly increase tax revenues to plug the gap with income, the shortfall in income tax that's forecast, the increase in social security spending, and then on top of that, the additional spending that I think we all acknowledge is going to be required to hit our child poverty and climate targets in particular. A lot of the discussion this morning and a lot of what's referenced in the document so far takes the approach of emphasising the need to essentially grow the taxable economy, increase economic performance, etc. The points that have been made already around folk in higher income tax bands, replacing those who are moving out of the oil and gas sector, etc. Is the government's position that the wider changes in economic policy, wider improvement in economic performance is the primary way to increase tax revenue? Or is there an acknowledgement that there will need to be direct changes to tax policy as well if we're to increase revenue by the amount that's likely required?
I think there's the point that Mr. Johnson made in recognising our disproportionate reliance upon income tax as our primary devolved revenue raising mechanism is an important one. And there's limits in which we can to what we can do with income tax before we start risking the points that the convener raised at the opening of the session around distortionary effects, behavioural change, and then you can start potentially risk losing revenue. And I know this was an area that the previous committee explored in the last session. So while we will always consider how we can best use our policies on income tax, and particularly on that strategic objective of about being responsive to society shifts, fundamentally the key task is to grow our tax base. And how we seek to achieve that is ultimately kind of set out within the National Strategy for Economic Transformation and supporting documents. So we will always look for ways in which we can ensure our tax system is efficient as possible and maximises revenue. I think the key challenge is to grow the number of high-paid, high-skilled jobs in Scotland, and in turn, that will help to... it will directly lead to increased tax revenue. I don't know, maybe, Alex, if you can maybe give some context about how this document was developed in relation to sort of broader economic sphere. I mean, I'm conscious of we've got a focus on tax, but how this document has been formed by work that goes on across government more widely, and particularly with pertinence to the question that Mr. Greer had asked about the interaction between seeking to raise revenue by direct taxation or increasing the tax base.
Yeah, I think there's no need for those two things to be looked at separately. It's all part of the same system. This is a framework about the way that we make tax policy. It talks about how you look at decisions in the round, and that's something that we've spoken about. But that is how decisions are made. So I think the question you're asking touches on lots of different aspects of the Scottish budget, how we set our devolved and local tax policies, how those taxes perform, and how we set out our spending plans. Those things all interact. So I suppose... the answer in terms of the framework is this is a framework that is telling the public and stakeholders how we make those decisions in the round and the factors that we consider and weigh when ministers come to make those individual decisions.
Thanks. And just turning back to the report that you mentioned a couple of moments ago, Minister, the Fraser and Valentine report into the Small Business Bonus Scheme. The top-line conclusion that I drew from that report was they're saying that there is essentially no hard evidence that the Small Business Bonus Scheme is improving economic performance. Could you comment on that? I know the Scottish Government is still developing its full formal response to it, but do you have any initial response to that? Because that seemed, given the amount of money that is put into the scheme, it seemed an alarming conclusion for such a respected institute to essentially say there's no evidence that this is working?
I would respond by saying that absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. And it comes back to that point around data. The challenge is actually having the data to evidence the impact. But I think what we do know is that there's support for it, for example, from the FSB. I think there's a recognition from many of the small businesses who have benefited from it. They value it. But I take the point you make.
Surprising.
Of course. But I take the point that you make around the need for more robust data rather than what could potentially be characterised as opinion or anecdotal. And that's why that, I think, the key recommendation, the key take from the report around data and the need to enhance the amount of data that we have is an important one, which will allow us to be more effective in shaping policy. Whether that be specific reliefs or whether it be for future consideration of more fundamental reforms. But the key issue is data. But I would note that in my experience in engaging with business as a minister and also as a constituency representative for the last 6 years, is that the scheme is very much valued by the businesses who receive it, and it's been regarded by many in a very, apologise if I'm misquoting, but I think it was described by the FSB as a lifeline. So I think it's important that we carefully consider what Fraser Vallander have outlined in the report, and that's why we're going to establish a short-life working group to consider it in more detail.
I agree absolutely with the FSB that we need a tax system that supports small businesses. But if you forgive me for being flippant, if we ask those who receive free money, is it a good idea that free money is given out? Of course, they're going to say yes. And the Fraser Vallander Institute's conclusions were concerning, given the amount of money that's involved. So just to dig down on that a little bit deeper as a final question, convener, what exactly is the data that we're missing? Because even before this report was put out, the framework, tax framework document itself does say we'll pursue a greater understanding of the drivers of devolved tax performance. What are the specific points of data that we are lacking at the moment?
I think what I'd made reference to earlier, there can be there's not necessarily a direct correlation between the rateable value of a business's premises and their overall economic performance. That's a key one. So I think that's part of it. But as I say, I don't want to respond prematurely before having given this the full consideration. As I said, we're establishing a short life working group, and as responded in answer to a parliamentary question last week, I will of course be happy to update Parliament in due course once we have an opportunity to fully consider the report. But I would just want to reiterate what I've said previously: is very much value report. I think it's an important contribution. And I think all the points that have been raised are pertinent. I don't know if there's anything that you'd want to add, Alex.
No, I think you've covered it.
Okay.
Thank you. That's all from me, Convener.
Thank you. The Federation of Small Businesses did say around a decade ago after the financial crash that without the small business bonus scheme, around 1 in 6 small businesses in Scotland would actually have went bust. So I think the question is really how effective it is relative to potentially other measures. Liz, to be followed by Douglas.
Thank you. Minister, you cited this morning that an effective tax structure is one that delivers what it says on the tin, and you cited the four principles of Adam Smith about what's good about the Scottish tin. I would say that an effective tax structure also has to be one that delivers the effective revenue that we need, specifically when it comes to addressing productivity and economic growth. And that's something that, as you know, has been flagged up by the Scottish Fiscal Commission, Fraser Vallander Institute, Chambers of Commerce, as being the serious concern for the Scottish economy. And both the convener and Mr Johnson made the point that whilst income tax revenue is just one part of the revenues that we can hope to receive, it is a major part. And what I'd like to ask you is about some of the concerns that the Scottish Fiscal Commission, particularly Professor Alistair Smith, raised about these returns, because Professor Smith was saying to us very clearly that when it comes to some of the regional aspects of income tax returns, there are areas like the North East which have been relatively productive in income tax revenue, whereas other areas have not. And so can I ask you exactly what statistical analysis is the Scottish Government doing to look at the projected changes in the industrial policy, which will affect employment, in each of the regions of Scotland to analyse what we think might be better revenue returns in the future? What data is being used for that?
Okay, I maybe ask Alec to come in just on that particular point around data and how it informs tax policy.
Yeah, so I think to bring it back to this document, what we're saying is that when we're setting tax policy and when we're managing taxes, we are looking for data that tells us how our taxes are performing. Mm-hmm. In terms of the very specific question, I'd be happy to come back in writing to answer that in a specific sense, because I'm not au fait with the particular data sets that you're referring to.
Right. Well, what Professor Smith was arguing is that obviously if there is a downturn in the oil and gas industry, and that projection works out on the same basis that we've had the downturn since 2014, revenues started to decline. If that continues, then something has got to come in to take its place in terms of the revenues that will accrue from employment in other industries. What I'm interested in is how well are we likely to be when it comes to the economic growth from other industries, i.e. not oil and gas, in somewhere like the northeast, that can replace these revenues. That's the statistics that I'm interested in, because obviously that will inform us about what's available in future years.
Okay, I think this is, it's touching back to the question, I think it was maybe the convener earlier on, is once oil and gas is no longer there, what takes the place? That's where we have a concentration of higher earners. And I would go back to the point I made before. Ultimately, this comes down to the opportunities that are presented through the transition to net zero. We have to make sure that's a just transition, but ultimately that's where the opportunities are going to arise. We know there's particular strengths in the Scottish economy, be that in food and drink, tourism, life sciences, higher education. There's an array of areas, but the opportunities ultimately are going to come in terms of the jobs that are ultimately displaced by the transition to net zero, by jobs that are involved in delivering net zero.
Precisely that, Minister, and that's surely the important data that we need, particularly in the next 4 or 5 years, where the projections from the Scottish Fiscal Commission on income tax revenue are really very weak. Is it not the case that we need very strong data about where the displacement from oil and gas would come when it comes to other industries and people who would be able to earn equivalent high sums of money that obviously lead to the increased revenues? Is there some analysis that is being done? I'm not saying it's easy, but is there some analysis that's being done to work out where the high-level industries of the future will be to improve the income tax revenue and therefore improve productivity and improve growth?
Let me just bring it back from income tax levels to general economic performance. I think that's what's captured in NSET and the evidence paper that is provided with it. But I think what we do is, if I can take that away and reflect, because I think it's fair points, and I'm conscious of the point I made earlier on about the need for this framework to remain a concise, high-level document. But I think probably what you're driving at is one of the strategic objectives in terms of regards to stable revenues. This needs to be unpacked to some degree to highlight these particular points.
I think, Minister, it's an absolute crucial area because, if the Scottish economy is going to improve and do really well, as we all hope it can, because it has got, let's be honest, a lot of potential within it, The fundamental point at the moment, which I think just about every member has mentioned so far, is that we're not doing as well as we could be just now because our income tax revenues are depressed and are obviously not growing strong enough in relation to the block grant adjustments. And therefore, you know, time and time again, when this committee has taken evidence from economic specialists and obviously from the official forecasters, that has been the central point. And what I'm driving up is the data that we need to inform the policy that the Scottish Government will have to engage with to ensure that, as I say, these revenues increase and that we are much more fiscally sustainable for the future, because at the moment, Scotland is lagging behind.
OK. I think in terms of the ask is to draw a more explicit link between tax policy and economic policy. We're considering almost this here in isolation as a tax framework. So I take that on board. I think the key point to bear in mind, of course, is that our income tax revenues in themselves are growing.
But not as fast as the block grant adjustment.
And that ultimately comes down to the different makeup of the economy in other parts of the UK. And I think we're all familiar with the concentration of financial services in London and the South East and the impact that has upon inflating earnings overall elsewhere in the UK and the challenges that that creates. So I think it's important, yes, we look at, you know, what are the drivers of earnings and economic performance? Absolutely, and that's what we're setting out our vision for that in the national strategy. But I think equally we can't lose sight of the impact of the block grant adjustment and the need for that to be processed to be considered as part of the fiscal framework review. So I take the point, around economic performance and the need to maximise opportunities and prosperity in Scotland, and that's what we're setting out through the national strategy for economic transformation. But we just can't lose sight of the block grant adjustment aspect as well, and just have to bear in mind that income tax revenues are forecast to continue growing in Scotland.
Yeah, I don't disagree, Minister. The block grant adjustment is essential, but so too is a tax structure that benefits Scotland in terms of increasing productivity and growth and being encouraging to investment. Just one final point. Can I ask, it was a point raised by the convener earlier, that he mentioned the fact that, you know, there is potential for internal migration from other parts of the UK, so that people come from other parts of the UK to Scotland, not to retire, but to be active in the labour market. What analysis has the Scottish Government done of those people who have come to Scotland about the reasons for them coming? Where have they gone? And on what basis has their productivity in addition to the economy been available to those who are looking at tax policy?
Okay, begin it from the front. Okay. And Alex, can you pick that up, please?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, so the income tax evaluation that we published did look at aspects of this. It was more specifically geared towards trying to understand whether our income tax policy choices had created or generated migration effects. And the broad finding was that they didn't. So
that they didn't?
That they did not, yeah. So we've been able to understand that to some extent. I think the question that you're asking is about whether our income tax policy would, for example, have a role to play in whether people would choose to come to Scotland.
It would.
That wasn't the focus of the income tax evaluation, but it is obviously an important question. I'm not aware of particular data that we have that can answer that question specifically. Would be my short answer.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. There are 700,000 Scots living and working in England, so not to mention those overseas. So clearly, if we had a strong and growing economy, then maybe fewer people would actually feel the need to move south or overseas. Okay, so Douglas, to be followed by Michelle.
Thanks, Convener. I just want to pick up on a couple of points that's been made this morning. One is oil and gas. Really just trying to work at you, I think it was the convener mentioned how many high-paid, high-skilled jobs were actually still linked to oil and gas at present. And then, so I'm trying to work out, so what modelling has been done by the Scottish Government on the decline in oil and gas, what that's going to mean to the Scottish economy, and probably modelling over maybe 5 years, 10 years, 15 years. What data is there available to see the impact on the Scottish economy?
Well, I don't have specific data in front of me with regards to what the forecast number of people working in oil and gas is going to be in 5 years or 10 years. Clearly that is something that's driven by a number of factors, and from a public policy perspective, by many levers that are not within the powers of this Parliament, as I think we would all recognise. The fundamental point that I'm making is that the transition away from oil and gas, as we all understand, is going to be a global phenomenon. It's an imperative, it's required. It's without it, we're not going to meet our 2045 targets. And so the broader policy objective is that we have a just transition which enables people who are operating in that sector, with the high skills and expertise that they bring, to deploy that within the emerging opportunities of a green economy. To deliver our just transition is going to net zero is going to present significant economic opportunities. So from a tax perspective, that is ultimately the objective would be that people operating in that sector, and not just directly in that sector, but in all sorts of other sectors, would have the opportunity to move into these high-skilled, high-paid jobs, these good green jobs that we want to see. And as such, that would help provide a steady tax base to generate the revenues that we require.
But it doesn't sound like you do know if it's going to be a steady tax base. If you haven't done the analysis, you haven't done the modelling. I'm thinking about an oil and gas platform just now. There's maybe like 400 or 500 people associated with that in terms of maintenance and being on it. When you look at an offshore wind farm, the number is considerably lower. So when we're being presented with figures on forecasts, how can we be assured that's right if you haven't done the modelling of how many jobs are going to be employed in the green economy and how many jobs are going to be lost in the oil and gas industry?
Okay. Is there anything you can add, Alex, in sort of the data we have available?
Just to make the point that we do analyse income tax data, we get outturn data. There is a lag, obviously, in terms of income tax data, but it is analysed. That feeds into the SFC forecast, the OBR forecast, and how we understand how the tax is performing. And then there's a question of how does the operation of the fiscal framework then result in effects on the Scottish budget? I think your question is more geared towards economic data, quite specifically in relation to the oil and gas sector. We do know that the oil and gas sector was a tax-rich sector, and that part of the income tax distribution is important and of particular interest to us when we try to understand the SFC forecasts and then try to understand the outturn data. And so all of those things feed into our ongoing analysis and how we take tax policy decisions.
Mm-hmm. I'm just thinking more of the projections ahead. We're given quite a lot of data at times, and we're looking at the divergence between Scotland and the rest of the UK when it comes to our economic performance. So there must be some projections on how many higher rate income taxpayers there are going to be over the next 5 and 10 years. And surely, there must be numbers being used for oil and gas when it comes to making those projections.
Those are factors that get taken into account in terms of the SFC's forecast. So the SFC will make judgments about that sort of thing in thinking about the forecast. We will analyse the outturn data and the forecast, and we have our own analysts as well who will look at these factors in terms of the overall income tax outturn data and the forecast revenues. So it is something that gets looked at in that broader context, but as regards the very specific data that I think that you're asking for, again, I would have to come back on that specific question about what data the Scottish Government may or may not have, because I don't have those facts at hand.
I think it would be good to know. It would be good assurance to know that there are some of the data is there, or whether the government are just, just crossing their fingers to wait and see, because I think we do need to know that.
Yeah, no, I don't think the approach that's being taken is that kind of
right.
approach.
Okay. So if the data is there, then it would be good to see that. I'll change subject slightly, Convener. In terms of the Citizens' Assembly for around local government funding, what is the exact remit of that assembly?
That is not determined yet. Ultimately, what we have is an agreement in the shared policy programme with the Scottish Green Party. We're at an early stage in terms of how we're going to develop this process, but we are going to be working at pace. clearly any remit has to be consistent with what's in the policy programme, so resourcing of local government, including council tax, and it will ultimately be for the Citizens' Assembly as well to consider what particular issues it wants to explore within that remit. And as I said earlier, I wouldn't want to prejudge it.
It's just when I think of local government funding, I do think of things like non-domestic rates. So, will that be in there? And then it seems strange that there's commitments being made, especially around, you mentioned it today about the small business bonus scheme. There's commitments being made on changing the who's going to be liable for council tax, for example. So it's almost like the Assembly's hands are being tied before they're starting, because you've put down some ground rules here already. Or would that be fair?
Well, I take the point that you're making, Ms. Lumsden. There's a combination of commitments, which are manifesto commitments, which the government was elected on. They are commitments which are a product of the joint agreement with the Scottish Green Party. Fundamentally, what the Citizens' Assembly will produce will take time to implement. And I think there's a recognition that depending upon how significant and how profound any of the changes advocated for actually are, it could take some time to implement between legislation and potentially a period of implementation beyond that. These other measures that we have committed to, such as maintaining the small business bonus for the lifetime of the Parliament, should at least 100,000 businesses benefit from it. That's a commitment for the life of this Parliament, which we're elected on. Our commitment on council tax with regards to extending exemption to 22 is a commitment we will deliver in the lifetime of this Parliament. So that is something that is a commitment to. It's there, it's providing that certainty that's something we're going to implement. The Citizens' Assembly, ultimately, there's an element of the unknown, in the sense that I cannot predict what the outcome of that Assembly is going to be. It's for the Assembly to engage in these deliberations and to bring forward proposals. And I'm very conscious I don't want to see anything that would be seen to preempting that particular process. I think we all recognise that there have been long-standing discussions and debates around local taxation. All parties have engaged in particular pieces of work, either independently or on a cross-party basis, to explore potential changes, amendments, or replacement for council tax. And I think we would all be keen to see what the Assembly comes up with, and give the proposals that can emerge from that process the due consideration and respect that we deserve.
But the remit won't be for the Assembly to determine. That will be for the government to determine. Is that correct?
The remit will be consistent with what we have, what the agreement was with the Scottish Green Party, which is already.
So non-domestic rates, is that going to be part of the remit or not?
I'm not in a position to outline what will be specifically within the remit at this particular place. There's a commitment through a deliberative process, engagement with COSLA, and I wouldn't want to preempt that. Mm-hmm. But I can assure you Parliament will be kept fully abreast of all proposals as they are developed ahead of the Citizens' Assembly's work commencing.
Okay, so those businesses that would like to see reform of non-domestic rates, they're not really going to get any comfort from the Citizens' Assembly, then, are they?
Well, I'm not precluding what the Citizens' Assembly may or may not choose to deliberate upon. As I said, you can look at the exact wording that is referred to within the framework for tax and the programme of work that we're undertaking. And I am it's incumbent upon me to ensure that the remit of the Citizens' Assembly reflects that shared policy commitment that was agreed with the Scottish Green Party, and it will.
Okay, and in terms of timescales for the remit then, following on from John Mason's question, we have no timescale for the Citizens' Assembly, we have no real timescale for the remit either.
It's what I would say is at this point is we're working at pace on it.
But that's not a timescale, Minister, that's just, it almost feels like the can has been kicked down the road on this.
No, the can's not been kicked down on the road on this. Not in a position yet to announce timescales, but when I am, I will make sure Parliament's the first to know.
Okay, thanks, Convener.
Thank you, Michelle. Good morning, Minister. I've just got a couple of short questions at the end. When I read through the framework for tax, and I asked myself what word jumped into my head for how I felt about it, and it was probably unobjectionable. You know, it does what it says in the tin, the Scottish tin, or as Liz Smith says. But picking up on the comment from the vice convener, I thought at kind of overarching level, what specific and measurable difference will the framework make? Because there's little to object to it, and yeah, there's clarification, but so I'd appreciate that. And also, not just at more detailed level, but which the vice convener was asking about, in general terms, how will you know it's been a success?
Okay. I've touched, I think, in the previous question around some of the aspects around metrics. So asking, you know, what difference will it make? One thing I haven't touched on is that I made reference to in my opening statement, as I'm very keen that it can help us to elevate public discourse around tax. I hope the committee knows that I'm very, it is something that across the range of my responsibilities that I'm keen to see advanced, is to have transparency, improved engagement, and more substantive discussion. I know the committee welcomed the work that was undertaken in preparing the guide to the spring budget revision, and that particular approach informs how, you know, I want to see the framework for tax implemented. So while this is a document that's setting out how the government will go around how it will approach tax policy, I think it also provides a framework, a tool for others to bring forward tax policies, be that within Parliament, be that the general public, stakeholders, Civic Scotland. So I hope it can help to act as a tool to catalyse a more informed and more reasoned debate around tax in Scotland, and recognising the important contribution that tax makes. And I think that's important in the context of the existing powers that we have. And I think it's also important in the context of any changes that emerge via the fiscal framework review or any subsequent devolution. So along with all of the stated objectives around transparency and demonstrating the government's commitment to ongoing engagement and a culture of continuous improvement, I hope one area it can also contribute towards is providing a strong reference point, a foundation for a more substantive debate around tax. And I hope that's something that I'm sure that is something that we all, a view and an aspiration that we all share.
Okay, thank you. Sorry about that. Yeah, and I can see how the principles plus with the two additions provide the possibility of that kind of discussion. One area that's close to my heart is, and returning to it again, is around tax avoidance. And you correctly point that out. Of course, we've got, the last figures from the House of Commons for tax avoidance at the last quarter last year was £35 billion a year. Now, obviously, we don't know what that equates to in Scottish terms, but it's obviously a huge concern. So, and it may well be that Alex needs to answer this, but how is it structured within the Scottish Government to really ensure that there is a focus on avoidance, and I mean in the Scottish Government rather than legislative authorities, local authorities or whatever. Do you know how many FTEs you've got to look at that? Is there a department who heads up that? What management accountability is there for it, and so on? I'd just like to appreciate a bit more information about how it's actually functioning in government, given the importance of it.
Well, I have to appreciate the role that Revenue Scotland has, and obviously Revenue Scotland is directly accountable to Parliament, but if Alex wants to come in and add.
It might be helpful to try and sort of just understand the question. You're asking what focus there is on tax avoidance within the Scottish Government in terms of understanding ongoing avoidance activity.
Yes, so what I'm trying to determine is the link between it being a principle and regarded as important, you know, it is specifically mentioned, with how that translates into real spend or accountabilities, whether it's Revenue Scotland or so on, how that actually flows through, because it strikes me that there is a possibility that it might be something nice that we say, but it doesn't necessarily translate into real resource and real focus on it. So I'm trying to get more of a sense of that.
I think in the framework for tax, what we're saying is there is real focus on it, but that focus needs to start from the outset. So when policymakers come to consider tax changes or tax proposals, the scope for avoidance activity needs to be a primary consideration at the very outset in terms of policy design. That's what the framework for tax is saying. It's our job, in terms of officials with ministers, to live and breathe that in relation to specific policies. In terms of whether avoidance activity has taken place, then it does come down to the tax authority in terms of their reporting. And I think you mentioned the £35 billion. That probably refers to the tax gap that HMRC calculates. So there is a distinction between policymakers and the policy-making process and whether or not avoidance activity is taking place, and that would sit with the tax authority in terms of administering the tax. There is a loop, though, around reporting on that, us as policymakers understanding it, and seeing what we can do about policy design to reduce it as much as possible. But it's on the face of the framework because it is of fundamental importance to us when it comes to making tax policy and advising ministers in terms of their decisions.
And therefore, in terms of the policy change or devising new policies, as you've set out, what underpinning further detail do you have in there, like policies to support people? Have you gone as far as developing that?
Sorry, I'm not sure I 100%
again,
follow the question.
So people will look at either changes or new taxes. It's more likely to be changes, given our sort of discussion today. What supporting information, policies, focus and so on have you already got in place to support that?
Well, sometimes we will think about things like behavioural responses to policies as part of the process. Whether or not that gets to the point of avoidance activity really depends on the specific situation. So I think it's hard to generalise in that way. I think what you're asking is, do we know exactly how much avoidance activity is taking place? Is that what you're getting at?
That'd be great to know as well.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I think, we won't know exactly precisely what every individual taxpayer is doing. As the Scottish Government, we won't understand what every single taxpayer is doing. We do rely on the tax authority to administer policy efficiently and effectively, which they do. And we do have a constant dialogue with them if a particular situation comes up. But as I said, as regards policy making, that really starts from the outset in terms of how we design policy and making sure that we minimise the scope for tax avoidance. I'm not sure if I framed that answer particularly well, but I think what I'm saying is that there is a specific element to this in terms of each different tax and the activity that's taking place. The framework for tax is necessarily high level. We've talked about that today. In terms of the framework, all we can do is seek to make policies that will reduce the scope for avoidance activity. And that's what we do try to do.
It's hard-baked into the process. We don't design tax policy and take decisions in tax policy without giving serious and detailed consideration to issues around avoidance. And how we can achieve that is obviously through this policy consideration, the work at Parliament doesn't scrutinise legislation. Before we even get to that, we're having a continuous dialogue and engagement with the appropriate tax authority who can bring that technical expertise to bear. So that is the approach that we take. And what we're trying to convey in the framework is it is a central concern. It is very much not an afterthought or something of secondary importance. It's intrinsic to how we go about designing tax in Scotland.
Okay, thank you. I mean, you've talked to Minister about how tax-rich oil workers are as a proportion of the Scottish economy, and you've also talked about the need for a green transition. But what evidence do we have that people are transitioning from the oil and gas industry into green jobs at the same salary levels that they enjoy in the North Sea? Because clearly, in terms of taxation, that's what's critical.
It's a fair point, and I think we've sort of touched on that earlier about the limitations of the data that we do have available. But I take the points that have been raised by numerous members on the committee around data, both in the here and now and with regards to forecast, to be able to more clearly evidence that transition as it takes place. And that's something I'm happy to reflect on and take away and come back to the committee with in writing.
Well, I'd appreciate that. Daniel?
Thank you, Convener. In fact, I've got two supplementary questions. The first follows straight on from that. I think that question is actually broader than just North Sea oil and transition. I mean, just a number of the answers actually, I think, begged further questions around what forecasting the Scottish Government undertakes. So we know that the Scottish Government is about to publish a multi-year spending review. Presumably, there is going to be forecasting that forms part of that so that the Scottish Government has some view of what revenues will be generated over that same period. So can I ask, is the Scottish Government just relying on the Scottish Fiscal Commission forecast? If so, is it doing any further interrogation, or is it undertaking its own forecasting? And I think this is quite an important point around what forecasts it uses and where they're generated from. Could you just clarify what the Scottish Government is doing?
If I could maybe split into two parts. Obviously, we have to, we're under statutory obligation to use the SFC forecast for our budget, so we need to use SFC forecasts. The broader point, I think, is one around economic data and how that can inform economic policy. So getting to a more granular level about particular individual sectors, regional breakdowns. I think these are some of the ideas that have been surfaced and explored at this session this morning. But ultimately, in the context of an RSR, we have to make assumptions. In a budget setting process, we have to use what the SFC gives us. And we also are dependent upon what decisions are taken at the UK Parliament as well. So we can certainly engage in our own independent forecasting, but it would be potentially duplicating existing work that's already taken place. So I suppose the question would be, what's the added value? What would be the additional forecasting and additional work that would be required to inform policy-making decisions beyond just the numbers that are given to us by the SFC? Have I understood you correctly?
No, you've not. In fact, in your preamble, you said it's about the how, and it's not about the how, it's the what. You know, it's really, you know, if it's just the SFC forecasts, and then how, I mean, and again, any data set, it's not just the numbers themselves, but actually what they do in terms of your process. I mean, I just think actually, if you could maybe write to the committee and just clarify kind of where in the process forecasts fit and what forecasting takes place, both and how you use the SFC data. I think that would be helpful.
Okay. Just to clarify, because we're talking about, but I had a big focus here on income tax revenues. Mm. It's what the SFC and what the block grant adjustment say that we've got to operate with. We can come up with a separate set of forecasts using a different model or methodology, and that's, you know, it's an academic point. What we have to work with is what the SFC give us. So I'm keen to get a sense of what is the additional forecasting that the committee would like, you know, is asking for the government to explore.
But it's not necessarily about the additional forecasting. It's just what forecasting you're using. What data sets you use? Is it just the SFC? Is there additional forecasting that takes place? On what basis is it broken down? I don't think it's just about oil and gas, but I think it's a sectoral, regional forecasting that takes place. And ultimately, you must be assuming that the Scottish Government has some influence on tax receipts. So it's therefore about how is that modelled and forecast and baked into your decision-making? And I think an understanding about how that is formally taking place in the decision-making processes in government is pretty important.
OK. Happy to take that away.
That'd be great. So the second question I've got, you mentioned that the Scottish Government would seek to have full devolution of income tax, full devolution of VAT and full devolution of national insurance contributions. So I just clarify two points. First of all, when you say full devolution, are you talking about the full devolution of both setting but also collecting those taxes? And is it just limited to those taxes, or would you also go further down the list, because those are the top three taxes across the United Kingdom in terms of receipts? The next one down would be corporation tax. I'm just wondering if there are other levies that you'd seek to devolve. And my estimation on those three taxes would take the total tax revenues in terms of all taxes levied, it'd be around 70% of taxation you'd be seeking to be devolved to Scotland if you include the ones which are already involved. Is that roughly what you would estimate it to be?
Well, as you would expect me to sort of preface my remark, is that you understand what the government's objective is and constitutionally and what its views and where fiscal decisions should be taken. These remarks were specifically in the context of the fiscal framework review. And I saw earlier on to set out some of the reasons why, you know, some of the immediate policy challenges that we face that cannot be addressed by not having control over these particular taxes. So that's why these three are highlighted. I also recognise with next there's the added complexity of its interaction with the benefit system as well. So decisions around the process for devolution, the implementation and the operation would have to be consistent with the framework. Now, we obviously have, as tax authorities, we have HMRC operating with the devolved elements of income tax, which works effectively and efficiently. I think that was recognised through the independent evaluation. We have Revenue Scotland for the two fully devolved taxes, and also have local authorities as well for the local taxes. I think what would underpin any of the approach to questions around operation would be what would be consistent with the framework for tax, and so that's how that decision would have to be taken. We're obviously approaching the fiscal framework with a set of asks. What emerges out of that would ultimately determine questions about delivery and operational matters.
So you'd be seeking devolution through the framework, so essentially those additional levies would be devolved in a manner akin to income tax, albeit there's some debate about the detail of that. So can I clarify that that's what you're saying? And is it just those levies, or are there additional levies you'd be seeking to have devolved?
Well, what we have set out is these were the three asks in the context of the fiscal framework review. Should there be opportunities for further devolution of tax beyond, that is something, of course, we would want to explore. One topical example was the issue potentially of a windfall tax that has obviously been raised in exchanges in the chamber. So clearly, if there are opportunities for further devolution of tax, that is something we would want to see. We believe all taxpayers should be in the control of this parliament. But in terms of what our commitment was and what we sort of prioritised in the manifesto and what our key focus is going into this fiscal framework review, for the three taxes that we mentioned. And obviously, it's contingent upon the outcome of that, what the exact operational arrangements would be.
Thank you.
Actually, my final question was on similar lines, but my curiosity is about why it's those three particular taxes. So we look at national insurance VAT and the remaining income tax, you know, savings and dividend. I would have thought, you know, those are quite complicated. So, for example, VAT, I've got a business in Glasgow. I then sell, supply another business in Manchester, which then sells something to a guy in Aberdeen. So you've got all this chain of VAT. So it's quite complex. And certainly in previous sessions, we've looked at how difficult that is and where the UK would suggest VAT would accrue to Scotland or not, as the case may be. So why have you not picked, for example, fuel duty? I mean, if you buy fuel, it's in Scotland, you know, because of the geography of the country, you'd probably get a disproportionate amount of it. Or indeed, excise duty. I'm pretty sure that in terms of, you know, tobacco and alcohol receipts, we exceed our 8.3% population share, so it would actually give a higher proportion. And these taxes are surely much easier to collect. This is, of course, assuming the UK government was in any way interested in actually devolving these. But why have you picked the priorities you have picked relative to some taxes which, frankly, would be a lot less contentious in terms of how they're calculated and be much, much easier to deliver and see bring in a higher proportion of revenue?
I think, Convener, you identify a tension between that exists between administrative complexity but also policy impact. And I think the taxes that I've referred to, particularly around national insurance contributions and VAT, you can have real, there's a potential for significant policy impact through taking these decisions. Now, I'm not saying that's not the case with the other taxes, and I appreciate that in the context of talking around fuel duty, it's taken on an added dimension with the cost of living crisis and the events unfolding in Eastern Europe, which obviously this framework predates. But the key point I would make is going back to just the examples of issues that we could address with powers over national insurance and VAT earlier on. For example, this marginal rate that exists between the higher Scottish rate and the upper earnings limit, VAT around in terms of its implications for, be it deposit return scheme and our work on decarbonising heat in buildings, and some of the challenges you'll be aware of with regards to VAT around refurbishment and renovation of property. So there's areas where it can be impactful. And there's also just a question of, I think, going in with a clear set of asks and a clear set of objectives with regards to further devolution of tax policy within the context of the fiscal framework review. And as a point, final point I would make is just a point that Mr. Johnson made, which is to recognise that they are significant revenue-raising taxes. And having that broader suite of taxes, a broader basket as such, it means we're not ultimately as reliant and as exposed to volatility on income tax alone.
Okay, I have to say that the kind of choice of taxes to me, though, doesn't really fulfil, if I was picking some taxes, the four criteria of Adam Smith of certainty, proportionality, the ability to pay, convenience and efficiency. I mean, I just think that some of these are so contentious, particularly VAT and who gets what and whether Scotland actually benefits disproportionately or not from an assignment. But anyway, that's no doubt a discussion for another day. I was going to ask some further... Sorry?
No, I was going to say, as I take the points that you make, but I think there's also just that question, as I say, about impact. And I did make reference to fuel duty, but VAT is a key element, of course, to the pump as well. So again, it's an example where I take the point you make about the tensions around, you know, potential administrative complexity and deliverability, but they can be worked through in a way that's consistent with the Adam Smith principles in terms of that's how you go about designing and implementing a tax and the devolution of the tax. But what you actually do with that lever when you have at your disposal, that national insurance contributions can be quite impactful and can, I think, allow us to shape policies more appropriate for Scotland.
Fuel duty and excise duties are also very impactful as well. Anyway, we'll conclude there. I do want to thank the Minister. It has been quite a long session, so I would like to thank you and Mr Doig for the clarity of some of your answers, although there's still a wee bit I think that the committee wants to hear about further, so we'll appreciate some correspondence on that. And that concludes the public part of today's meeting. The next item on our agenda, which we're discuss in private, is consideration of a draft report on the resource spending review framework. So we now move into private session, but first of all, we'll have a 10-minute break.